Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for today's webinar, Understanding Blockchain Technology for Trusted Microelectronics Supply Chain Applications Webinar. My name is Ann Webster, Manager of Corporate Membership at the National Defense Industrial Association, and I will be your moderator for today's webinar. All attendee lines are muted. If you have a question during the webinar, you can submit your question in the question box in the webinar panel on the right side of your screen. We will do our best to get through all questions during the Q&A section of this webinar. As a reminder, we are recording today's webinar for NDIA members unable to attend and for anyone who wishes to review the material at a later date. It is now my pleasure to introduce Nikhil Shenoy, co-founder and CEO of Colbin Run Network.
Thanks, Ann. Good morning to everyone joining us from the West Coast, and thank you to those on the East Coast for joining during your lunch break. So my name is Nikhil Shenoy, co-founder and CEO of Colbin Run Networks, as Dan mentioned. And what I'd like to talk today to you about is understanding blockchain technology for trusted microelectronics supply chain applications. There's a lot going on there, and just a kind of a brief overview of what we're going to cover here. I'm going to tell, for those who are not super familiar, we'll go over what blockchain really is and kind of separate the Bitcoin use case from the underlying technology, which is very important. Touch a little bit on microelectronics applications, and then from there, we'll talk about how those two frameworks could be used together to drive some meaningful impact particularly in the DoD space, but I think more broadly as well. So again, by way of introduction, this is Colbin Run Networks Incorporated. We are about a year and a half old, and we've been seeded by the Department of Defense through the Small Business Innovation Research Program. So we have two SBIRs that we're currently focused on, one of which is actually building a blockchain for trusted microelectronics. In that DoD SBIR, we're also working with Digital Bazaar and Virginia Tech. So Manu Sporting and Dave Longley at Digital Bazaar, they actually are significant contributors to the W3C standards and wrote some of the standards that we'll talk about today. And then Dr. Patterson is a researcher at Virginia Tech who had a long career at Xilinx beforehand and was very familiar with some of these trusted assured microelectronics processes, like formal verification. All right, so the most important thing, if anybody walks away from this presentation with one learning, I hope it's this, that Bitcoin is not blockchain, and blockchain is not Bitcoin. Just like email is not the internet is not email. Bitcoin is simply the most popular and very first kind of useful use case of the underlying blockchain technology. You know, blockchain technology was released in 2009. You might have heard of Satoshi Nakamoto is kind of the pseudonym of the person or people that created the system. And the real breakthrough wasn't the technology. Because, you know, blockchain is now 10 years old if you start from Bitcoin. And even before that white paper was released, a lot of the technologies were already 15 plus years old. So what's new? The real interesting piece of blockchain is the distributed nature of it and the incentive structure behind Bitcoin. I think that's what really kind of made this thing take off, or the incentive structures for people to kind of contribute compute to really build infrastructure around the Bitcoin use case without a central authority necessarily leading the charge. That's the real breakthrough. Okay, so again, Bitcoin is a decentralized digital currency that popularized the blockchain distributed data structure. So let's talk a little bit about how it works. So the basic idea behind blockchain is that someone requests a transaction. I'm going to give Ann some money, $5. You want to make sure that I have $5 in my account. And if I have $6 and I give Ann $5 and I say I'm going to give somebody else $5, you want to make sure that I don't just create $4 out of thin air. Right? So I have $6 in my account. I'm trying to spend $10. It doesn't work that way. So that's what we call the double spend problem. And that's the problem that Bitcoin effectively solved by introducing some inefficiency, which we'll go to in a minute. But the idea here is that I say I'm going to pay Ann $5. The transaction is broadcast to the network. And then step three is that the transaction is validated. And then once verified, the transaction is represented in a block of transactions that gets stacked on to the chain of blocks, right? So you have this kind of cryptographic hash of sequential blocks of transactions that get distributed all over the place, all right? And then the transaction is complete. So why is that necessarily useful, and how do we separate the Bitcoin from the blockchain? So I want to kind of draw that out. Right? Suppose that I transact forget money for a second, but just do a certification. I issue a certificate, or Alice issues a certificate to Bob. Okay? That's useful in the token Bob has carried around. If he loses it, almost like a car title or a bearer bond or something, there's a lot of risk in just a pure physical transaction. But it worked for thousands of years. In the last few decades, we've kind of come to these trusted third-party systems, whether it's banks or clearinghouses or what have you. Alice will report the transaction to a trusted third party who keeps a ledger. So a ledger is nothing more than a record of transactions. It's a specific type or a use case for a database. That's probably a good way to think about it. What distributed ledger technology does, or decentralized ledgers, is they take a ledger and make multiple copies of it, have lots of people kind of agree on what's allowed to be written to those ledgers, and does that over and over and over again. Okay? So what you write to that ledger is very important. Okay? I don't want to go into too much detail here, and happy to follow up with anybody interested. But there's the design of a blockchain ecosystem is very important in terms of what everybody gets to see versus what information is allowed to be written to it. Right? So the way you think about that is on-chain, the system that gets distributed here to all these individuals in between Alice and Bob, that's called on-chain. And off-chain is a proprietary data that Alice and Bob have that they might not necessarily want to share broadly. I'll go through an example of that in a second. So the trade-offs between blockchain technology versus a legacy database are important to understand. I don't know if anybody on the phone has seen a blockchain demo, but a lot of times it'll look like something you were able to do 15 years ago, but with a loading bar, okay? Because blockchain really is fun. And I'll get to that also later in the presentation. But the main thing that I want to hammer home on this diagram here is that you're giving up simplicity. You're introducing complexity. You're giving up strict confidentiality. You have to have some kind of actionable data, right? And the performance is usually slower than a traditional centralized database system. But in return for giving those up, you're receiving a higher level of compliance or governance. You have less kind of honeypots of data, right? Because you don't have that centralized Equifax type of gold mine that people might attack directly, which is interesting because I will talk about credit reporting in a minute. And you receive a degree of robustness in that, you know, if one of the nodes goes down, by definition, the entire system still remains. Okay, and you might, for somebody on the phone might remember from 2009, we had a node go down in the form of Lehman Brothers and it disrupted the entire system. Because of the way blockchain is engineered, you can avoid that depending on the adoption of the system, which is very important. Okay, so when does blockchain make sense? So this is a three-pillar approach. That this is just my opinion. You know, NIST has their opinion, and DHS has several papers out there. GSA also has a lot of interesting stuff from the government. But my view on Colvin Run, is that with these three broad categories, you might have a useful use case for blockchain. Okay, and the way I talk about it is blockchain is almost like certain implementations of blockchain can be looked at like a space shuttle. No one will tell you space shuttle is a bad idea until you use it to commute from Chicago to DC. Right? So the use case matters a lot. You know, wings are useful, seats are useful, windshields are useful, but a commuter jet is very different from a space shuttle. Right? So that's where I think a fit for purpose blockchain makes a lot of sense, and we'll get to that as well. But anytime when you have multiple parties with different incentives, okay, so think of a supply chain, for example, I think is the best example, where everyone's trying to sell more microelectronics, but along the way, they have different incentives to buy and sell that amongst themselves. It's just a financial incentive. There might be other incentives like security and national superiority and things like that in the supply chain as well. But the point is that they have common goals but different incentives, right? Regulated boundary conditions. You understand where the handoffs occur and who is responsible at what point, right? And who can attest to certain transactions? What are the rights associated across those boundaries? And I think that DoD microelectronics is fantastic for this because there are so many regulated boundaries and regulations to adhere to that it's pretty clear, right? And it's voluminous, but it's relatively well defined as to how those exchanges might happen. And the third and most important piece, right? Data is the new fuel, and that still applies here. So you need to have data that actually is meaningfully shared. When I share this data on this select piece of data on chain, it actually makes a difference. And I think this is where a lot of blockchain use cases fall down, is that they share data for the sake of putting on a blockchain when a database would have worked just equally as well, right? Because the other two conditions were not necessarily met. Okay, and a lot of things are done without blockchain today, but that doesn't mean that it couldn't be done better, right? And so we'll keep that theme in mind as we proceed. This is a little bit about the SBIR that we worked on through DoD, specifically Defense Microelectronics Activity, or DMEA. We built proof of concept blockchain system for trust assured microelectronics to capture information along the way. So these are the features. I won't go into them in detail, but I think the most important thing really are the two on the upper right-hand side, right? Interoperability, the ability to plug something in and know what you're going to get, and a unified data model, the ability to kind of capture a variety of different data types, but then serve them up differently to stakeholders along the way, right? So the DoD's needs are very, very different than a commercial supplier's needs or a prime needs as well, right? So all of those different constituents are, you know, might have different risk metrics for what gets accepted that ultimately it winds up in a DoD fielded system, right? So there's a couple different approaches to how that's being done today, and I want to talk about how blockchain might apply to that in the future and what's needed to get there. So just to kind of bring that to life a little bit, what does blockchain, what are some really useful blockchain use cases? So verifiable credentials or identity are a phenomenal use case. So I don't know if anybody on the phone saw Superbad, but this is a fake ID on the left. And the trouble with identity today is that it's too broad. Right? Why does a bouncer at a bar or a liquor store need to know where I live? All they need to know is that the state of Hawaii says that I'm above a certain age, right, in a verifiable way, okay, and that it's authentic or valid, right? So I'm giving them a lot of information, but the fact that my hair and eyes are brown, for example, or that I'm male and how tall and how much I allegedly weighed when I filled out the form, none of this matters for that specific use case. And similarly, you know, other forms of identity get used a lot. I mean, anybody who's under 60 years old or so, you don't use Social Security, but you use your Social Security number constantly, right? I mean, I contribute to Social Security, but I use it for finance, I use it for identity, to recover information, educational records. There's all kinds of use cases for Social Security, but it was never really meant to do that. And that's part of the reason why it's such a problem today. The other kind of interesting use case is governed data aggregation. So I mentioned credit reports before, right? So basically a credit report is a risk metric, okay? And there's a couple of reasons why this is a great analogy for trusted and assured microelectronics, all right? So I want to spend a little bit of time here, where a score like 760 you see here means different things to different people. So if I am a high-level credit card issuer, like I want to buy one of those Black cards from American Express, my risk metrics for that card are going to be very different than somebody who is 19 years old and maybe just starting out of college or serving in the forces and wants that $500 kind of Wells Fargo college card. But they use the same credit report, right? The credit report and experience and all that is the same for them. And so understanding what standards, what those use cases are, what the metrics are, and how they apply for each of the use cases, and then before that, how the data is aggregated. So whether I use American Express, Discover, Visa, MasterCard, Diners Club, I don't know, maybe I'm forgetting some, but no matter what credit card I use, those metrics are the same, right? Usage, ratio, available credit, age of my oldest report, number of new inquiries. And then there's a lot of information that's not on the credit report, like income, number of checking accounts, right? And those might also be factors, but the credit reporting industry has kind of landed on these standards over time, right, to determine that these are the risk factors that we can aggregate, collect in a somewhat meaningful way, and, provide banks, car loans, even cell phone carriers, and all variety of users kind of plug into this credit reporting architecture in the way that they see fit. And so that's why, Colvin Run's approach has been trying to develop a credit report for microelectronics that incorporates the standards, metrics, and use cases along the way. So I won't go through every single one of these reasons, but open standards are extremely important, okay? But they're not perfect, and how they are designed matters a whole lot. I think one of my favorite examples is Lego, where you could build Millennium Falcon, or you could build, a little toy soldier or what have you, but the blocks always fit together in a specific way, and there are certain permutations and combinations of the blocks with a lot of creativity, but it's somewhat limited in a very deliberate way, right? HDMI. I don't have to worry about whether my specific HDMI cable is going to work in a specific case, right? I don't call the building beforehand and ask them what kind of HDMI cable they have. I just ask them if they have it, right? And I know exactly what it's going to do. It's going to project from my system onto another. The reason why I put plug points on the slide is to demonstrate a different type of standard, whether you might have regional standards. So DoD standards, for example, in microelectronics, might be very different than those that are adhered to in the Google Nest. Now, I believe that DoD is ahead of the curve in terms of the security and integrity requirements, which we'll get to in a minute here. But how you put these standards together matters a whole lot. And because, Power Grid, right, to use another analogy, was kind of developed separately, it's very similar, and there are transformers and things, but when you plug your device into the wall, you have a general, you know what you're going to get out of it. You might have a black box on there that transforms it to the requirements of your exact system. But, it is important to know where you're going, right? If I take a device, for example, India, that, and I have a U.S. Issued device, I need to make sure I have the right configuration to plug into that system. And, oh, by the way, I need to have some kind of regulations that my system doesn't, get fried because it has too much electricity through it, right? So understanding the standards and then dealing with them are almost as important as building them in the first place. All right, I hope that's clear, and if not, we'll get to some of that in the Q&A. So these are the standards that we're using for trust insured microelectronics. The Varies Delta blockchain is highly flexible and configurable for a fit for purpose system. So we're still kind of taking these different building blocks and putting them together in a meaningful way to address trusted and assured microelectronics requirements, starting with DoD and then growing them out. Right? So again, the metrics, standards, and use cases still need to be built, but the technology that serves them up is ready to go. So as I mentioned before, blockchain is just a piece of the stack. So this example here is from TradeLens, which is the spin-off of the Maersk and IBM shipping initiative. So you can look up TradeLens online, and there's a lot of reference material. They're really great. But here, blockchain enables a kind of standardized view of multi-party transactions without compromising proprietary data. And the way that it actually does that is through APIs and those services. So think about those, I'm maybe dating myself, but sharper image boxes that you plug your stuff into that plugs into the Indian or Israeli plug point and it acts as a little translator. There's a lot of those translators that are required when you're dealing with this kind of centralized system. And here they're using blockchain as almost a trust anchor. So they have services that are built on top of that kind of blockchain approval piece. And, if you run through the NIST or even the Colvin Run framework, do you really need blockchain for this? Not necessarily. But then why wasn't the TradeLens use case done before? Right? And so I'll get into the analogy and I'll draw it out again in a few slides here. But think about this, right? Before the internet, how did people transact? How did people, suppose if you wanted to go to a football game, how did you find out tickets and whether you're paying a fair price or what seats might be available, right? There are brokers, you might have a friend with season tickets. It's a very inefficient system. So I think what blockchain does is it enables you to kind of speed up the creation of an architecture as long as it's well-designed, flexible enough, and well-thought-out, again, the standards, metrics, and use cases that are broadly applicable but narrowly well-defined and achieve that that actual mutual benefit. Okay, so design is everything. All right, so a little disclaimer before I move to the next slide. I see the audience here, and I know that there's a lot of views on trusted microelectronics, or some people might say you don't want to trust, you protect your microelectronics, versus assurance. Okay, so from here forward, the trust insured microelectronics pieces are just my understanding of having worked in this marketplace for the better part of 2 years. And I'm really interested in the group's thoughts on kind of where this is going. As you might guess, based on the credit report analogy, I believe that there are components of trust and assurance, or protection and traceability, whatever you want to call it, and we need something that kind of bridges the gap between those two. Okay, and this is where I believe that trusted and electronics, trust and assured microelectronics, putting them both together, makes a ton of sense. Something that's methodically aggregated, actively curated, securely distributed, and deliberately focused with the right use case could really unlock a lot of potential in the microelectronics space that has a lot of inefficiency in it and a lot of long-term technical debt built up over the last few decades. So for those that might not be quite as familiar, to me, trust is knowing, right? So others in the industry, the way it's been presented to me in a few other places is guns, guards, and gates, kind of the old school way of knowing, understanding your supplier, having standards that they adhere to, having categories of microelectronics that they need in order to be fielded into DoD systems. And it's actually a very valid method, and it works. The push is for assurance, or something more quantifiable. So along the lines of a credit report, but again, the credit report still has an element of trust to it in terms of who's actually allowed to write, like Visa, Discover, MasterCard. There are still gatekeepers to that quantifiably assured system. So that's where I believe trust-assured microelectronics kind of bridges the gap between these two, right? And blockchain is an ideal enabling technology. So the components of trust and assurance to me, and these are generally accepted framework for security overall, are integrity, accessibility, and confidentiality. And blockchain enables all of this through the infrastructure, right? So all the stuff that we discussed before, whether it's immutable, so you can't necessarily trust something that changes a lot. It has to be verified. You have to know where that information came from or who gave me permission to, field that system or use that IP. And accuracy. Protection, encryption, and identity also kind of go hand in hand with the security piece, and they fall under confidentiality. There's also more dimensions to confidentiality, and I think blockchain addresses the integrity and accessibility pieces really, really well. And confidentiality is, like I said, there's many degrees to confidentiality, right? Garbage in, garbage out is a problem no matter what. Understanding, how people want to get to information. And in fact, the shift towards confidentiality is such that there's even talk about things like zero trust, where you just assume that you've already been compromised, okay? So, again, this is an active area of debate. I understand there are many viewpoints here, and I just want to say that, using an open standards-based approach, blockchain or otherwise, does have some benefits, as long as you develop those metric standards in a meaningful way. So for those that for me personally, I have a tough time kind of visualizing a lot of these boxes and arrows, and I didn't want to give any classified or sensitive examples. So I just thought this is an example of how trust and assurance go hand in hand. So for those of you who have not seen Star Wars, I apologize, but I was kind of hoping that this audience might lean towards those who have seen it. So you have a fully operational system that's assured and it performs the way they want. You see that, Galen Erso, for those who might have seen Rogue One, he inserted the back door to destroy it. There was a confidentiality breach and that those plans got out. Akbar over here, his team reverse engineered it, found that vulnerability, and compromised the system. Okay. So this is kind of a visualization, and what I have here is DoD's take on this. So this was presented actually at the NDIA microelectronics meeting, I believe in February earlier this year. And they talked about trust and assurance in the same breath there. And so there's a lot of effort going on. There's a lot of stuff going into it. But, again, the danger of boxes and arrows is you want to kind of focus on what you want to address. Okay, and that's where I think, breaking this down into its pieces is really important. And DoD is actually doing a wonderful job of this. There's several initiatives here that I think many people on the phone are probably familiar with in groups that are looking at this. So very quickly, MNSEC is kind of the overarching mandate. It's a program of record. AFWERX Supply Chain Challenge, they're actually presenting next week at the ITC Test Conference here in D.C. There's an open solicitation on the street called MNSAVE, depending on who you ask, through AFRL. The Naval Surface Warfare Center Train had the Microelectronics Integrity Meeting. There's a Smarts OTA that made some pretty recent awards on prototype FPGA security. JFAC and VMEA are heavily involved in it. You know, OSD is focused on this. And for those that that are interested in learning more, there's actually several events coming up the remainder of this year, one of which is the TAME Forum, the Trust and Assured Microelectronics Forum. I believe it's in Gainesville sometime in December. And there's also an NSF initiative called CHEST, which I forgot to put up here, that's, you know, I don't remember what the acronym was, but look up NSF CHEST. I think it's nsfchest.org. But yeah, there's a lot of interesting kind of different approaches being taken to trust and assured microelectronics, and trust and assurance are talked about in the same breath. And even here you can see that Navy chose to put integrity in the title. That was their focus. So, so it's very exciting to be a part of this system. I think NDIA has a great a position here as a somewhat impartial third party, an industry organization that can make an impact across these initiatives. So to bring a little bit to life kind of what I was talking about before, here's the microelectronics ecosystem today. A lot of one-off transactions. All the major suppliers, you know, if you think about FPGAs, for example, Xilinx, Microchip, Intel, they all have their own validation system. Microchip, for example, uses X509 certificates and embeds them in the system and has a database of records that they measure against, and that's different for each supplier. So there's a lot of overhead involved in providing highly secure microelectronic components. It still gets done, just like people bought tickets before the internet. But what we propose is a governed infrastructure, right? So blockchain is the approach that I can think of and our team is taking right now in partnership with the VMEA and others. And what I like to think of is StubHub, okay? So StubHub is not an aggregation site. It's not necessarily like Amazon Marketplace, right? It's a type of marketplace where people interact with it for free and then pay to transact, okay, once that kind of match is made. So OpenTable is another great example of matching these supply with unmet demand, right? Undiscovered supply and unmet demand. So the best example I can think of is I'm a grad student or a startup person that wants to develop some kind of IP. I don't know that I can get a certain EDA tool, for example, for an academic license. As an EDA supplier, I want to get my tool in that person's hands, but when it goes to production, know that I can build on that, right, and charge them appropriately, and that the academic or startup license is being used more broadly. So I think that there are some controls in place that we can use. And again, using the StubHub example, you might not think of StubHub as a standards body, but whether I buy a ticket at MetLife or, Redskin Stadium or, the Oakland Coliseum, soon be in Vegas, the way I buy tickets is the same, right? So I can see all the prices. There's a little bit of discovery that goes on in terms of what seats are available. I can zoom in, maybe see a little bit about the seats, but they're all presented in kind of the same way. So that's kind of another more graphical example, I think, of what a standard can really accomplish. So again, I think this is where, building the sustainable system and having those metric standards and use cases built out is going to be extremely important. So, my ask or call to action for the group on the phone and anybody that views this webinar in the future is let's try and build some of those standards and understand what that ecosystem would look like and appeal to a broad range of stakeholders, starting with DoD, but, potentially expanding to commercial over time. So thank you very much for your time, and I think we have some time for questions, right?
Yes, definitely. Thank you so much. And as a reminder to our attendees, if you all do have a question, you can submit it in the question section on the panel on the right-hand side of your screen. I guess one question is if there are, some key takeaways from the presentation today, if you were to pinpoint a few.
Yeah. So I'll just do my top three.
Yeah.
I think number one is Bitcoin is not blockchain. Blockchain is not Bitcoin. In fact, I think that public blockchains like Bitcoin and Ethereum are very different from private blockchains like Hyperledger, various Delta, and the various other platforms that are out there. So I think that's point number one. Point number two, I'd like to think that trust and assurance, I don't think that there's a silver bullet that either one is right by itself. I think that there is a common approach that is required, kind of similar to a credit report. And the third piece, kind of tied to the second one, we need to develop and understand what are the artifacts, so what are the metrics, standards, and use cases that really matter for, you know, to improve the supply base of microelectronics to DoD.
Awesome. We do have one question. How can one make an immutable connection between hardware and a written ledger for ME supply chain security?
So there's a few different approaches to that. One of the things out there that I've looked at is something called DARPA Shield, Supply Chain Hardware Integrity. I got myself in trouble again with acronyms, but it's out there. Look at DARPA Shield. And, you know, and what they have is they have a method to kind of create an identifier for hardware components and then write that to a blockchain, in a cryptographically hashed way. So if the characteristic of the hardware changes, then the validation falls apart. There's also another really cool startup out there called Dust Identity. Shout out to Eric Charette. Good guy. If you meet him at these events, I strongly recommend talking to them. So Dust Identity has a kind of an interesting solution for similar kind of immutable identity of hardware. So those solutions are out there. I think the challenge is that, again, the use case, right? So let's talk about Shield for a minute. I think one of the key problems with Shield is how you read it. You know, you have to put that system right on top of it almost to kind of read the identity, and then there's a whole separate process for validating, right? So I think some of the use case issues need to be worked out more broadly before we get, you know, broader adoption. So whoever asked that question, I hope they answered it, and I know there's a lot more there. So.
Okay, next question. As DoD is moving towards centralized cloud solution, the decentralized nature of blockchain seems to conflict with this trend. How do we make sure the solutions work together seamlessly?
Again, I think it goes back to the use case, right? I'm trying to think of the best way to answer that. Cloud and blockchain are two very different things. And I mean, a lot of people will tell you that because of cloud, blockchain is invalid, and that they don't go together. This is why I think, you know, using the term of a distributed ledger is a little important. Because keeping that record in a governed way, having that ecosystem, whether you use blockchain or not, is what really matters. And how you enable that, to me, I think having this open standards-based blockchain is probably the simplest way. See the question again real quick?
Yeah.
Just want to make sure I address everything they said. So I don't know if DoD is necessarily moving to a centralized cloud solution, right? I mean, I've seen stuff out there, like Trusted Silicon. I know that's a solution that I've seen at a few conferences. But I don't know that that's the whole solution, right? I mean, some of the stuff might be viewed as like a marketplace to kind of put everything together. But when you do EDA, you know, doing EDA in the cloud is very difficult for a variety of reasons, right? When you're designing microelectronics pieces, the compute and all the stuff that kind of goes into bringing IP together in a cloud is challenging, right? So that's one. I think the second thing is that making sure the solutions work together seamlessly, it's investing, right? Making sure that we make the proper investments to kind of fail small, fail fast, and learn. So how does everything need to be a single solution? Is there going to be like one, even in the credit reporting space, right? I think you go to three different credit reporting agencies, you have three different credit reports. So it's not perfect, even though the methodologies are very, very similar. So I think, you know, whether something works or not, I mean, it's kind of a little bit of a black or white question, right? How do we make sure the solutions work together seamlessly? I'd rephrase that into how do we make sure that, you know, the standards are set such that solutions work in an acceptable manner? It's something like that. What is the acceptance? What are the artifacts that we'll accept? And a little bit more thought around that, I think, is what's really needed.
Okay, next question. Do you see a difference in how DoD and other government agencies approach trust and assurance as opposed to commercial systems? For example, most programs in DoD require assurance of FC security, while commercial systems work on resilience to attack.
Yeah, Yeah, and that's where the dual use thing kind of becomes a little bit tricky. Frankly, I don't know that commercial enterprises, I mean, they care about security to the extent that it impacts sales. Whereas DoD has a very different use case in terms of supply chain. So again, you know, the assurance of supply chain security, and this is where, you know, I want to be a little bit careful because there are so many different approaches within DoD itself, right? I know that Department of State and DHS have their own kind of approaches to the supply chain security. They're all slightly different. And if you go to ACT-IAC, there is somewhat of a voice towards a centralized approach that is coming together across government. And I think, you know, this is where I would defer to somebody who's more on the policy side of things, because the technology is not the problem, right? Do I need defense-grade security in a Google Nest? I don't know. I think that, you know, there is a general push towards provenance. I mean, people want to know where their food comes from. I think you saw a little bit of that in Google Nest, for example, when they found out there was a microphone in it, that wasn't necessarily being used. And so, you know, as we move into a more electronic society, I mean, everybody, you know, has at least one phone in their pocket now that has more power than a space shuttle did in terms of compute. Like, I think that it's going to become a bigger and bigger problem, and it's growing and evolving over time. So the answer to the question is yes, I think there is a difference, and that is one of the things that a standard can help resolve, is what are the commonalities between those different approaches that still enable all the different approaches.
Okay, we have one more question. Are all components of this in private blockchain, or are parts in a public blockchain?
Are all components of this are in private blockchain, or are parts in a public blockchain? Okay, so no. The way I'm interpreting this is that the frameworks are the same, but the parts are not really, right? So Bitcoin, for example, uses something called proof of work, where computational resources are used to solve a problem that gives them the right to validate that transaction. So once the transaction is validated, the winning node, if you will, gets paid for mining. So that's what mining is they get incentivized to validate that transaction, and then that gets shared amongst all the other nodes, right? So that, you know, the cryptographically hashed version of Nikhil is a cryptographically hashed version of AND $5, so Nikhil gets debited, she gets credited, and the system goes forward, right, of what that ledger looks like. That's proof of work. In ours, we're not using compute as the consensus mechanism, right? So again, that's why I think it's important to realize that there are several different blocks that are used in a blockchain system. So, just for some of those blocks, it's the ledger itself, the database that gets written across all the peer nodes. You have the verifiable credential, which is the identity of that component. So it doesn't have to be a person, but you might have the credential ascribed to a specific chipset or even a specific module, like a chip itself. And then you also have the decentralized identifier. So how does that get referenced? How does the virtual credential get referenced, right? So all those building blocks, there's several more, like JSON-LD, which is the linked data system, can be used for things that are completely different, right? So a private blockchain can be completely different than a public blockchain. And that's, again, where I think the vocabulary needs to evolve. You know, some people talk about blockchain as cryptocurrency and the private blockchain as distributed ledger technology. But even there, I think there's some nuance that hasn't quite been resolved yet.
Thank you so much, Nikhil. And thank you to our attendees for joining us today for the webinar. As a reminder, this webinar was recorded, so we will be sending out the recording and a copy of the slides to all attendees within 2 to 3 days. So thank you so much, and we hope to see you again for our next webinar.